apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, students, family, friends, colleagues, partners in ministry from across the world, and our special guest, Jesus Christ. Welcome here tonight. It's always important to take a photograph to just remind yourself who you spent a year with in the Word. And it's always been great for us to have photographers here that help us. So thank you, Dwayne Denton for photography, and Hilton Pelser now. Hilton Pelser photography, what do you call your photography? There we go. And also want to thank everybody that made the venue so beautiful, prepared it, behind the scenes, the catering that tastes so great, and the team that set things up for us. Let's just give them a good hand, guys. That picture that you see there on your table, the road to discipleship, is just a photograph I took on a farm in Fallwater. Fallwater is in one of the northern provinces of our country, if you didn't know. And we greet them as well, if they're watching. Apostle Andre Oerendaal and his friends. They planted a church on one of these farms, and we were preaching there in the afternoon in a little shed with all the farm workers. And as we came out, I took this photograph of one of the dirt roads, and it's something that means something to me. Apostle Andre, my dad, has gone through many countries, dirt roads, and if you remember him from Rolex Magnum, he was Dr. Livingston cutting a jungle path with his lawnmower through Africa. Rolex Magnum, Dr. Livingston, I presume. And he's followed Livingston's footsteps through Africa and many dirt roads. And he can tell you some more of his stories. But the Lord once showed me when I was ministering at a youth conference in Onitsha in Nigeria with my friend Pastor Mornay, I saw a vision of a dirt road. And I knew that there were roads that we hadn't traveled on before that we'd need to take. And we have apostles here who have gone into Africa and done some interesting things in farming and agriculture and church work as well. So they can relate to me when I say there's some roads that are less traveled that we need to take with the grace and faith of the Lord. Amen. And that's what I want you to think about. We're training people and we're equipping saints for the work of the ministry so that they can go on the road less traveled and make new highways for people to walk on later. You need to be brave to take the road less traveled. You need to be willing to be discipled or be disciplined to become a disciple. And I want to give you some of the rewards for faithfulness in discipleship tonight. One of the rewards for faithfulness is that fruit of the Spirit of faithfulness becomes cultivated in your life by the Holy Spirit. It's not just you making a decision to be faithful. You are now allowing the Holy Spirit to make you faithful and to cultivate that as a fruit in your life that others can eat from. Secondly, impartation takes place. When you are faithful, you start entering into the labors of apostles and prophets who have gone before you, and that impartation of gifts takes place when you are faithful. Paul said to Timothy that you must stir up the gifts that is in him through the hands laid on him by the elders. And the Bible also says, don't lay hands on anyone suddenly. Lay hands on those and impart gifts of the Spirit in those who are faithful. People who are willing to knuckle down, roll up their sleeves and work when it's time to work. Who are willing to serve and not to be served. Who are willing to study to show themselves approved of God. Diligent workers, rightly dividing the word of truth. Amen. So apostolic impartation. Thirdly, God's nature of faithfulness is available to you. He will make a faithful way of escape for you in any situation if you are faithful to Him. In 1 Corinthians 10:13, He says, He will not tempt you above that which you are able to bear, but He will always make a way of escape. And we can testify how the Lord has made ways for people even to get here to Bible college. It's miracle Bible college for some people how they got here. Amen. How some people stayed here during the year with visa problems is also miracle Bible college. How some people get to class from Fishhook to Milnerton every day is Miracle Bible College. How people who are busy at work, who have families to raise, but they study the Word once a week in a Bible cell, and they do their best, and they learn the Word, and God's Word starts growing in them, that's Miracle Bible College to me as well. What I also enjoy tonight is seeing a faithful representation of a cross-section of society here. We see people from every race, amen, from every city around in the region, from every age group. We've got little kids here from children's church and youth that have also attended sessions where we've taught the word, and they're going to get accredited tonight by God, amen. So it's great to see all nations here tonight, isn't it? I think God's happy. Amen. So faithfulness in Revelation, if you're faithful unto death, you get the crown of life. Cheer up. Faithful. If you're faithful in sowing, you'll also be faithful in reaping a harvest. Amen. If, for those of you who don't know, MBC or Miracle Bible College is the training division of Harvest International Ministries. And we are harvesters of the great end time harvest. Amen. We're bringing in souls for Jesus. So this training division here is training people all across the world. And maybe tonight is the first time that you've realized that there are other people studying what you're studying in your Bible cell, in your group, intimate group at church, or wherever you are. But I want to make you aware of the greater family that you're a part of. Amen. I also want to encourage you that faithful family meets together every year in Wellington for a summit. So you're welcome to attend our summit in April. And the theme there is God's family, which you're all a part of now. Amen. It's nice to know you've got a bigger family. Faithfulness in sowing and reaping helps you to enter into the labors of others. And let's read John 4, verse 34 to 38 together. I'll read it for you. Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to finish the work. Don't say there's still 4 months and then comes the harvest. Behold, I say to you, lift your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest. He who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this saying, it is true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you haven't labored. Others have labored and you have entered into their labors. And through faithfulness, you start entering into the labors of those who have gone before you. You start going into territories where apostles have broken the ground and sowed seed and others have waters. And you start going in there and you start reaping. Amen. Recently, I went to follow up a work Apostle Andre and Ola did earlier in the year in France. And they call themselves La Maçonniers en Action. That means they are the harvesters of action. And they relate to us now as well in Paris. Huh? And it was nice for me to go and meet with them and follow up what they've done and reap where others have labored and follow up those relationships. And I want to encourage you students tonight that are graduating, I want you to lift your eyes. And through faithfulness, God will allow you to reap where others have sown. But you will also then go and sow, and others will reap from you as well. Amen. So through faith and patience, you will inherit the promises God has for you. Imitate faithful people who, through their faith and patience over the years, have inherited the promises God has for them. Apostle Andre tells people about church growth, and they ask him, "How do you grow a strong church? How do you get people to work with you, you know, on the level that they do and to have the motivation that they do?" He said, "We never motivate people. We let Christ in them motivate them to do what they're doing. They're doing it for the Lord." Amen. And they ask him, "So tell us your secret. How do churches grow?" And Apostle Andre says to them, "Slowly." That's it. You need faith and you need patience, and you will inherit the promises. Amen. Faithfulness creates entry points into the spiritual realm for you. Some of our lecturers have been worshiping God for 30, 20 years. And over that time, they've been faithful in worshiping the Lord in spirit and truth. They've created entry points for others to also flow prophetically in worship. Some of our lecturers have been involved in the arts, in drama, and in dancing. And through their faithfulness, they've created entry points for others to go into the field with their arts, to even earn a living through the arts. So we thank the Lord for their faithfulness, and we enter into that. Faithfulness draws the seal of approval of God's Spirit on everything you do in His name. So let faithfulness describe all the spheres of life that we're a part of, so that we can reflect Jesus, who is the one who's called faithful and true. Let us become faithful ministers by His grace. Amen. Faithful brothers and sisters. Faithful in love and marriage. faithful children, faithful stewards of His mysteries, faithful disciples, faithful churches, faithful networks, faithful Bible colleges who stay true to the Word, faithful like our High Priest and King Jesus, faithful like our Father in heaven, faithful like our witness, the Holy Spirit, our comforter and friend. And faithfulness has become personified in a many-membered body of believers, Jesus Christ, amen, His church. So I want to bless you tonight and thank you for making an effort to be here on a hot day. But by what I've heard, it's hotter in Wellington. They think they came down here to cool down, so thank you for someone who's also been very faithful in what he's done over the years, faithful in relating to us, faithful in reaching his community, prison ministry, building a church in his community, getting people to work together in Mbukweni, is Pastor Nkokalele Mtanga, to whom I'm going to hand over now so he can speak to us from his life. Let's hear from a faithful man of God. Amen. Amen. You need a mic. Hy het 'n mikrofoon daar sê. There's your mic.
A very good evening. What a beautiful people. I see a lot of new faces, and we want to thank God for that. This move is moving. Amen. Tell somebody next to you that we are moving. The second thing I want to say is it's such a wonderful experience and a feeling to see old faces too, who has been here even before I came. It's encouraging. Apostle Aja, I want to do something that I know that it always happens, but with this group of people, we have to thank God and honor Him for our leader and the founder of this move. I was thinking these few days when you said I must share, and I thought, whatever I will share, but I have to share this part. I know elders of our church, board members, sometimes they used to say these words, but a person like me or like somebody who came here last year is tonight saying, thank you, Apostle Andra and Prophetess Nola, for lying down for your lives and going to many nations on our behalf. And tonight I'm going to share a very simple message that has been shared all the years that I was here. A message that you already mentioned speaks about harvest. It's amazing in Harvester, you plan to share something and then somebody else share before you say. But it's a very encouraging thing. Apostle Andra has got a message that has got only one word that says go. And in case you forget the scriptures, I will read because I will not read from this book of Matthew 28. I will just quote verses 18, 19, 20, where the scripture says, go ye unto all nations, and you know what it means. And as we are about to end the year and go to holidays or stay on holidays, I want to encourage you to have a word in your mind or at the back of your mind that says, go. You might not go to any other nation, but in your village, in your community, as I do, hear a word that says, go. When I look at the dictionary, this word, go, it says, walk. You might walking to the school, to work, to a friend, but I'm saying tonight, God says, go. Make a move. Your nation might not be other nation, but it might be your neighbor. Therefore, go. I try to look at my notes since 1996. And I was blessed by this word that I know that to our leader and the founder of this move is a lifestyle. To me and you, it might be just a message that you will forget tomorrow. But amazingly, when you call and ask, where is a person? You will hear that he's there. It's few Sundays or weekends you will hear that he is preaching in our church. Therefore tonight, take this word very heavy and ask God to reveal to you. And I want to honor God for his life. And I want to say thank you for teaching us that we must not worship man. But tonight, Harvester Network, let's shout, let's clap hands and make a joyful noise and thank God for our leaders.
Join me in doing that. Thank you, Jesus! Glory to God!
Hallelujah. Saying these words to our leader, I am not leaving out our elders, as I mentioned, that I know behind doors, behind the screens, they are working hard and making things in order. I know with an experience that I had good times with people like Pastor Billy and others. When it is tough in my life, they speak life to me. Tonight, I'm going to read a few scriptures from the book of Matthew. So if you have got Bible, turn with me with the book of Matthew chapter 9. And we will read a few verses starting from verse 35. Verse 35 sounds like, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. I just want to hold there before I go down to 36. I want to repeat this verse because I want to share a perspective. And Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogue, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. It doesn't say preaching and teaching. It says teaching and preaching. I hope you are with me. The reason I'm emphasizing this part is this. I once became part of other church where they preach so beautiful, where they preach a lot, but no teaching. And tonight I want to encourage especially the young people and those who are, you know, done one or two subjects, that you did a great thing to study the Word. Because if you study the Word, you are able to teach the Word. Where I'm staying, and I believe also in Kailisha, they will agree with me, people are preaching. And they are really preaching. You can see them that they are preaching. They are not using a little handkerchief, but, you know, they come with towels because they are preaching. And tonight I want to encourage you that what we learn from Apostle Andra, if you study the Word, you will teach the Word. There is one scripture similar with this in Matthew chapter 4. Please bear me, I want to go there. In Matthew chapter 4, which is also similar with this scripture, saying same thing, because I want this to be a DNA of the apostolic and prophetic ministry. Because it can make you to make a difference where you are. Verse 23 in Matthew 4 says, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogue and what? And preaching. Teaching in their synagogue and preaching the good news. Amen. The good news is the kingdom of God. Amen. The good news speaks about love, joy, peace. Same, the kingdom of God. So tonight, if you really want to make a difference, step up this Word and trust that God will make you to be able to learn. When I came here 21 years ago, somebody was not born yet here. I was not ready to learn or to study the Word as I thought I wanted, but I find that no, not me. But it took some time and a willing heart to see that, wow, God is doing it. Today I'm not afraid to stand and be able to teach a word. Although I thought that, no, I'm just a pastor. I'm just a pastor. But when you are part of this house, you became part of this house and you are everything that you desire. Go back to chapter 9 where we were reading. Let's go to verse 36. When he saw the crowd, he had a compassion with them on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. In this verse, I want to single out one word: compassion. I want to single out this word because it's a deep word. When I look at the dictionary, it came up with a very two simple words. And one of these words, compassion, means pity. Pity. And the second word that I found is sympathy. Those are the words that are very simple and we understand. But tonight I want to say compassion is bigger than those two words I mentioned. There is no right word from the English or from on any other dictionary that can explain. When Jesus saw the crowd, he was moved, that's another version, with compassion. And tonight I want to tell you that compassion comes from God. Nowhere else. It comes from God. But the funny part is that even if you can have compassion, it's not for you. If God gave you a compassion, it's not for you. But it's for those who are in need or they are helpless. It's for those that are confused, that are stressful, that are harassed. But they don't understand that they need compassion. They need you to have compassion on their behalf. And then you end up doing something. Because why? Because God is expecting you to do on his behalf. So my word tonight, especially to the graduates, I want to encourage you to seek and ask God this gift. It might be already inside in you, but you don't realize, you don't recognize it. It's a gift with an understanding. Because when you see that person who's in need, you understand his or her situation better than himself. He might think that, you know, I need money. He might think that I need work. He might think that I need to get married. But once you quote a word from Matthew 6 and you say, you know, seek first the kingdom of God, then you reveal something to that person. I know some of us will use taxis. Some of us will use trains. Some of us will walk. I want to ask you to download this app. I'm coming with an app. And this app is Compassion. You don't need a data. You don't need a data. Especially those who are using Vodacom. I'm sorry for you. But in our days, we need something like this that comes from God freely. Then we use it in a way that people will be shocked and ask, how did you get this? The last verse. I want to read verse 37. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Let me read 38 for the sake of ending the chapter. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest. Again, I just want to single out one word in this verse because this is familiar. I'm speaking to students here. I know my leaders have been doing this. I'm just here tonight to encourage them that, you know, well done, because you did to us. Workers. Other Bible speaks about laborers. When I look at the dictionary, I was shocked to find that when the Greek dictionary explained this word labor or workers, the first word was teacher. The first word I got was teacher under an explanation of a worker. And we read in our Bibles, you know, we think about workers or laborers, but the dictionary goes deeper and it says that kind of a person is a teacher. What I'm saying tonight is that without teaching the word of God, you didn't work enough. You are not a laborer. This word means a minister. Means somebody who's willing and obedient. And I tell you, even if you are doubting, if you are here tonight and you have done one subject, you are that person. You are that person. You need just to believe in yourself because God believes in you. Our communities, our villages are in need of this kind of a character of a person who worked very hard. When the disciples were fishing all night and Jesus came and asked them if they have got something, and Peter said, "We toiled all night." The word toiled means that more than normal work you have done. You work very hard. But it's so nice to have Jesus because he said, just throw the net on the other side. And you know the story. I don't want to go there. And I want to encourage you that if you have done that one or two subjects, you have got a potential, you have got ability to do more. It means you qualify to do more. I've got my classmates at the back there. I saw a few of them. And there's another one. He's wearing so beautiful. I was not a good student in terms of assignments and all things. But one thing I want to tell you is that before the end of my first year, I knew that I'm a pastor. How did I know that? Because my leaders saw what was inside in me, and they didn't believe in me. The only word that made me to go further and further is because I was told that I can do it. Because it's not about the marks you always get. I don't know where my certificates apostolate, but guess what? I am still holding a little paper, not even a half page, that Apostle Andra wrote as a remark of my assignments and all. I kept them. I kept that paper. It's 21 years ago. I don't know where my certificates that I got later after that. Because for me, it was a big thing. I don't mind anybody who's asking me, do you have certificates? You are a pastor? I don't care. I know inside in me that God gave me something that made me. But guess what? I'm still holding that paper. I can show you tonight, not tomorrow. I can show you tonight. Maybe it's there in my table. Here it is. Just tell them, Pastor Billy. Tell them. I don't have certificates. In those words, once again, I want to say congratulations to those who have done one or two subjects. Those who are full-time, I salute you. May the Lord bless. Thank you, Apostle. Thank you, Apostle.
One, two. Let me see that paper. Let's see that paper there.
I think I must ask man, you want to see one, two.
I'll see if I can. Can we not read it? Is it too personal?
No, you can.
Can I read it? Do you want to?
You're welcome. I just need
if, with your permission, thank you for those beautiful words. Wasn't it good to hear from you? Yeah. Amen. Second term, July 1997. Student Ntanga, we knew him as actor then, but then we realized his true name, Nkokalele. Your dream to be a full-time pastor has become a reality in a short time. May your other dreams be fulfilled too, as you continue to care for the poor and live a humble and kind life like Jesus Christ. That's a pretty good report there. Amen. Thank you for sharing that with us. It's also my honor to introduce Prophet Nola Pelsa, my mother. I've known her for a long time. Always been very close. But it's a privilege to work with her. The Lord said to me one day that her voice will still be heard in the nation again. She was a television presenter for many years on a religious program. And she did a good work there for the Lord, but now she gets to say exactly what she needs to on live streaming every Sunday. So with the help of our live stream team this week, we heard that it's now how many nations that we still need to reach before we've reached all the nations of the world? We need to reach another 18 nations, then we've live streamed to all the nations of the world. Praise God, eh? We've realized that we can reach the nations physically and on live stream, and putting that together, we're almost covering the earth. So we give the Lord the glory and the honor. And to work with a prophet is very important. If you have an apostolic ministry, to connect it with a prophetic ministry, they complement one another. And I've had the privilege of seeing my parents do this. And thank you, Prophet Nola, for your input in our lives and for the times that you spent counseling and showing us how to go deeper and deal with the lies of the devil and impart the truth into their lives, and we have prospered through the prophesying of the prophet. So thank you for tonight. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. Saints, holy men, holy women, the righteous. That's what God calls us. Isn't that amazing? Wonderful to be here. Thank you, Aja, for the kind words. Bless you. Pastor, I can easily join your church. I'd love to join your church. It's wonderful. You spoke so deep into my heart tonight, and you're speaking the truth. And John said, I'm so happy. Paul actually said it, that my children are walking in the truth. And that's what it's all about. I want to speak in a word of encouragement to the students who've just finished Bible school. You were on an amazing diet of the Word of God that strengthened you. And what I pray is that you will never go away from the Word. My simple encouragement to you is to daily eat the Word. Daily. Get up in the morning, You can make yourself a cup of coffee. You can get your tea and your rusks. And don't take your cell phone first. Take the Bible. Read and pray over your day, and you will see how wonderfully God will direct your footsteps, how you will have answers for difficult questions, how He aligns you because you got fed from heaven. You know, an athlete, if he wants to do well, he has to eat right. And that's the same with us. If we want to live right, we need to eat right. So living the Word and eating the Word has kept me all my life. And has made me grow. And you know what is so wonderful is when you make that effort, even if it's 5 minutes, you make that effort with the Word of God. God sees it. And He begins to reveal things to you. He says, He will show you things to come. It's amazing how God then begins to instruct you even in the night. You'd be fast asleep and you'll receive instruction. How wonderful is that? I love the Word of God, and I'm so grateful that God allowed us to start this training center here in Cape Town. We came from we gave a church away in Mondial, and then came from a big church in Pretoria, and God said to us, we must come to Cape Town and start a training center. And I'm so glad we did that. I'm so thrilled, because I was saying to Andre today, as he was signing all the certificates, I said, Andre, who would have thought that you're going to sign so many certificates when we started with 2 students in Mondior? For a whole year, Andre was teaching 2 Bible school students. And he said to me sometimes, Nola, I was so tired, I thought, I wonder if they really want to be there. But they were there. They were faithful. And that's how we started, small beginnings. We didn't despise those days of small beginnings. And you know, what is wonderful for me is that we could train our children and that they had the desire of their own heart to come and work in the ministry with us. It's been prophesied, but to actually see that happen is quite an amazing, because there's so much else they could do, but that they've decided to come and work in the ministry with me and Andre and following in our footsteps. I just want to give God the glory for that. You know, to really be a laborer, we had to put things aside. If you go and labor in something, you're hired as a laborer. You can't decide, nee wat ek gaan nou maar eers iets anders doen nie, or I will do this and then I will do that. You put your hand to the plow and that's where you're heading. You don't have to, you're not really allowed to look back. So a true laborer that is given, you've given your life and you've actually died to all the other things that might have looked inviting or so on, but that's just part of it. But I thank God that in the apostolic, God is using the whole body. So you've got your full-time workers, but you've also got people who are working in their job situation, because that's where God has called them. And I love that about the apostolic, is that God uses the ordinary people, and that the ordinary people are equipped for the work of the ministry, because that is what church is all about, is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. And you are all saints. So I'm a saint. Amen. We need to acknowledge and not have a mistaken identity of who we are in Jesus Christ. When we understand that, and we understand that we are King's kids, and that we actually are crowned with His righteousness and salvation, then we will understand that to lose our crown is not a joke. And then when the lure of the world comes, especially upon young people who's leaving Bible school, remember that there's a reward and you are wearing a crown. We are kings and priests. Don't let the devil steal your crown. Don't let anybody mislead you. Stay steadfast in the Word. Stay connected to the body. Stay connected to one another. Don't be a person out alone out there. You will not make it. Because we have an enemy that wants to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus came to give life, and I just want to encourage that with you. Keep the Word in front of you. Amen.
Thank you, Prophet Nola. And Teacher Neil's going to help me. We're just going to greet some people. And we're doing a Skype, some of our Miracle Bible College satellites and cells. And a couple of them decided to join in tonight. So I think it's just polite to greet them, don't you think? Okay, so I'm going to let him help me because, you know, while they're getting ready. Okay. Wayne. So what's interesting is a lot of the people that we relate to, like for instance, when I went to Paris now, I visited a family in Versailles. When I walked into the room, they said, "We've just been watching you on television, and now you're in our lounge." And that was quite wonderful. And then they fed me. The most amazing French beef bourguignon. My goodness gracious. And I was like, "You're being so nice." "No, it's like we know you," they said. I said, "Okay, well, you know my parents." Parents had visited there. But what it does is it just creates a contact point. And it opens up people's hearts for what God wants to do in that area. So what we've seen is it's a tool. So if we want to go into new territories, if you want to reach new territories, send them a link from the live streaming. You can go to harvestchurch.net and you can go on live stream. And it'll take it to our YouTube channel. And you can just get them to subscribe. And whenever we have events like this, like tonight or Sundays, they'll be notified. And that way we're spreading the word as well. So let's make use of it. And we're discussing how we're going to train people and equip people online in the future. There's ways that we want to do it. And we're trusting the Lord as we're building the church here in Burgundy Estate. If you have a moment to drive home, if you're going past that way, it's in the corner of Carmine and Siena Roads. Just drive past there and say, "It is finished in Jesus' name." Because we still have to finish that building. Amen. Thank you. Are we almost there? And to whom are we speaking tonight? Okay. Are we speaking to Harvester Birmingham?
Yes.
Okay, I can see an image.
Are you just warming up to get
to
what you're gonna do is I'm gonna turn it around. Can it be electric? And then if you will do this.
I need help to do this, so Ben did such a good teaching now at the conference in Paris on suffering. And it's so accurate with his Shakespearean English. Let's give him a call. Yeah. I must look there, not there. Then he'll think I'm squint.
Hello.
Hello. Is it Ben?
It is Ben.
Ben. So, Ben, we'd like to see you.
It is on.
Okay, we'll get there. And you must click on there.
You must click on the camera.
I can see you and I can see me.
Okay. Just give us a moment. We're on a screen. Hey! Ben, thank you for tuning in. You're now speaking to a few hundred people here tonight, you and Jacob.
Yes, me and Jacob.
Ben, tell us how MBC is doing in Harvester Birmingham and how you are and your family.
It's going well. We have, I think we have six students now. We've just finished a term with one of our correspondents by Skype, who Skypes in with us faithfully every week. So we're thankful for that. We had our graduation in September, the start of September, because of the English school year, which was good fun. And from the trip to France, I've had an email this week from a lady who's interested in also joining us via Skype as well. So we thank God for that and for what he's doing in the body through the Bible school.
Oh, fantastic. So where does she live from the Skype perspective?
Do you remember in Paris, do you remember Benu? It was her daughter.
Okay.
So I just need to connect with her and need to check how good her English is. We'll see if we can help her.
Otherwise, you can do a bit of français, no?
Wait.
Oui. Ben, I was so relieved to have you show me around Paris. It was wonderful to see you there. Do you know that they now want talking about a European summit in May?
Yes. Yeah. We're very excited. I think that should be something that at least myself can come to. Mary might have visa issues, but no, that's something that we are looking forward to as well.
We'd love to see you guys again. And how did your gathering go? You had a gathering in the UK as well.
It was very good. It was very good. We felt the unity of the Spirit, I think, amongst the churches in the UK and the people visitors in the UK. So it was a real time of breakthrough for some people, but just an affirmation of the unity that there is amongst Harvester Church and the unity in the Reformation.
Yes, thank you. I mean, it is the 500-year celebration of the Reformation at the moment, and it's been a privilege working with you guys to continue that work. And is there any message you'd like to give these young reformers graduating tonight?
I listened to what Prophet Nola said, and I can only echo that now is the time to get into the Word for yourself independently as much as you can as you go into the rest of your lives. And be excited, because for me, Bible school propelled me into something. I'm sure it will propel many of the students into other and exciting things.
Oh, thank you so much, Ben. We really appreciate your time, and we love hearing you teach. So we want to hear some more of that. Get ready for next year.
Amen.
Amen. I want to show you I don't think you can see everybody. So I want to, you can just give Ben a wave. There's a nice wave for somebody. And a wave on this side. There's Chantel. Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. Everybody say bye, Ben.
Bye, Ben.
Bye, Ben. God bless you, Ben. Regards. It's teacher Ben. Eh? Should have said teacher Ben. Yeah. Teacher Ben, you can still hear me, right? Okay.
On the last
stream. Teacher Ben. Then we were talking to Doreen.
Yeah.
And where is she in the wild coast Camus. Or the wild life? Or the? She's in Camus. Okay, that Doreen. Yeah. Why don't you speak to her, Neil?
Okay.
She's your disciple. Mm-hmm. So give me a microphone. Thank you so much, Wayne. Do you want to take this one? You take this call.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Doreen.
Hello.
Goeienaand. Kan jy ons hoor?
Gaan dit? Ek hoor julle.
Baie. Ons gaan net vir die gehoor se onthawe, kan ons dalk Engels praat vir die wat die Afrikaans kan verstaan nie?
Yes.
Oui. We're starting to see the image because in this hall, the internet signal is very poor, so it takes some time to render. It will eventually get there. We just have very poor signal here, as where we are in the church, is a really strong signal. So it will build. And where they are in Camus, they also have poor internet. So we are... No, it comes through. This one will just take some time to render. Doreen? Is your video on?
Yes.
Okay, kom ek probeer gaan weer. Kyk of hy laai. Okay. Okay, so I'm just gonna try again. So Doreen, she's a she was a friend of Karen, Karen Oss, and got introduced, and then they decided they wanted to join Harvester, and as part of that, wanted to come and learn through MBC. So she started as a correspondence student, and what we did this term was, instead of, we sort of had a like a Bible cell doing Skype. So what Ben is doing in France, we basically did with him in Camus. But Doreen herself, because she's studying and writing exams and finishing them off, she's also a good teacher. So she then teaches others. So she's got another student there with her whom she's been teaching. She's actually got two students, but the one is here tonight. We'd love to see them. Kom ons hoor maar 'n bietjie van julle.
Ja.
Vertel vir ons 'n bietjie van Liet. Is Liet of Nicolette?
Is Nicolette.
Nicolette.
Ja.
Ja, vertel ons
Nicolette.
Just tell us about what subject you did and yeah, what did the Lord show you?
The last one we did was the renewal of the mind.
Yeah.
And I learned quite a lot because I started my own school in Camus, and it helped me through a lot of situations.
Okay, you're able to apply what you learned through renewal of the mind in the school that you're teaching?
Yes, and in my daily life.
Wonderful. And Doreen, tell me, how did you experience the Skype connection other than the normal correspondence studies?
It was difficult for me because usually I especially when I studied, it was a bit difficult because usually I can go back to the audios and then I can recap if I want to remember something. So it was different, but it also lent me a lot more discipline just to get into it every week and join the class. That was a discipline lesson for me.
Okay, wonderful. Well, it is good to hear from you, and God bless you, and congratulations for finishing the year.
Thank you.
Yay! All right, God bless you.
Don't say no. That was a photo. Amen. Well done for getting them hooked up there for tonight, Teacher Neil, and the others who couldn't, they probably watch later, different time zones. But that's fun. And this shows you what you can do. So if you have friends abroad and people that are interested, let's talk to us. Let us help you set up NBC satellites and cells wherever you go, wherever you have friends. Amen. Amen. So thank you for that. I appreciate the efforts. Okay, we're going to carry this on. Okay. So, Apostle Andre, I just want to hear from Apostle Andre, who has now also got quite an itinerary for the first half of next year. On Saturday, we're doing another missions auction at a Mercedes museum. And we're all dressing vintage and selling art and having fun, raising funds for missions. God's opened up so many doors for him now in Malaysia and Philippines that we're now going back, and there's conferences being arranged. And the churches are very interested in what we're doing. And there's some Harvester churches there. So there's a lot of work for those of you who want to learn Tagalog. And those of you who'd like to learn the Malaysian languages and then Africa, there's a lot of work need to be done in Lugandan. We need to translate things into French. All right, so there's a lot of work there. Ivan, where are you? Please give us French classes next term. Are you here next term? Ah, oui. Merci beaucoup. Yes, that would be fantastic, so we can get ready for more French work. Pastor Andre, please come and share with us. Let's hear from you. The microphone.
Thank you so much, Pastor Aja, and the previous speakers, Kuklele, really blessed us, really spoke like a father already. Spoke into our hearts, and we appreciate that. and the work he's doing there. Always been a faithful friend. And Nola's encouraging words, and to see Ben and people on Skype is wonderful. And I just want to tell all of you, you look beautiful tonight. It's nice to have occasions like this and to see people dress nicely. You know, today's world, it's mostly a casual world. And people don't make such an effort anymore. But it's nice to see the effort made and to enjoy the evening together, all to the glory of God. Amen? Good. And Aja's already thanked everyone, so I'm not going to add to that. I just want to share a thought about God's perfect timing. Galatians 4:4 says that in the fullness of time, Jesus came. Jesus appeared. Jesus arrived. The fullness of time. As a young boy, I loved cricket, and I still do. And now I mostly play it in my mind when I watch. But I can still bowl a ball here and there. But Graham Pollock was one of the great batsmen when I was young. And when we went to watch cricket in Port Elizabeth, where his father was in charge of the EP Herald, I said to my dad, I'd like to meet him. And my dad was that kind of person. He said, well, let's go. Let's go. And we went to the offices. We said, my son wants to meet Mr. Graham Pollock. They said, well, you can't just come. You must make an appointment. He says, well, I'm making one now. I want to meet him now. And he went to the secretary. Secretary said, there's a young boy and his father that want to meet you. He said, come in. He went inside. And I remember him shaking my hand. I thought he's going to crush my hand because he's such a wonderful batsman. And he had a soft hand. And I thought, geez, he's not so strong. So when we sat down, he said, how can I help you, my boy? And I said, I want to ask you a question. He said, okay. I said, what is the secret of your batting? And he said, oh, it's one word, timing. He says, I don't practice much in the nets because bowlers want to hurt me. If I want to practice, I let someone throw the ball at me and I practice a shot. He says, but timing, you either have or you don't have. You can't practice that. You can't practice timing. And then he said, the next person you should watch is Barry Richards. He's got timing. And he also became a great batsman. So then I began to rely on something called timing more than practice. Because, you know, you can practice till you're silly, but you don't get better. But if you know what you've got and you rely on the gifts and the talents God has given you, then you'll practice more accurately. And in life, I found that God's timing is perfect. God is perfectly on time. So throughout my life, I've learned to say these words. I'm in the right place at the right time with the right people. You want to say that? So I'm in the right place at the right time with the right people. I say that everywhere I go. And often where I am, I meet the person to go to the next country. I said in Manila, they invited me to speak in a big conference. And I spoke. I sat down. We had some tea, a break. Lady Melanie from China, Melody, came. She said, I'm from China. China needs to hear what you have to say. If you come to China, I'll be your interpreter. I'll go around with you and interpret all your sermons. So, I went to China. The day I arrived in Shenzhen, which is just opposite Hong Kong, you can either go by bus across the bridge or a ferry or a plane. We went by bus. And the day I arrived in Shenzhen, I had to speak to the Bible college students. It's the underground church, but it's above ground. The day I arrived, just before lunchtime, there's a big commotion. I go outside. The leader of the underground church has just been released that morning from 7-year prison sentence in Shenzhen. And he came straight to the Bible school to encourage the students, met me, we had lunch together. The lunch was water, hot water. They give you hot water in a glass and hot water in a bowl. And then they dish up the hot water in your plate. And they put a chicken claw and sheep's teeth in your plate. It tastes very nice. It's very nice. You should try it sometimes. Good combination, the chicken and the sheep, yeah. Yeah, ek is net bang hy gaan jou krap of byt. But we spoke for a long time. He told me about his time in prison, how hard it was. I said to him, you know, did God help you through it? He said, to tell you the truth, I wanted to die most of the time. They treat you like a pig. This is very, very, very harsh. Anyway, he came to sit in where I taught, and afterwards we still had some chats. But to meet the underground leader of the underground church in China, that's far bigger than anything we know. When you arrive, it's called timing, and I had nothing to do with it. If you try to have good timing, you fail. You get nervous. Good timing, God's timing, works when you're out of the equation. That's why Jesus says, deny yourself and your timing will be good. You see, we think denying yourself is feeling sorry for yourself. No. It means get out of the way. That old lady said, I've been in the Lord's way for 44 years. The pastor said, well, sister, it's time you get out of it so God can do something. We get in the way of the Lord, you know, when we want to do His work. And when we want to try, when we try too hard. Thing is to relax in Him. Not just to relax, then you do nothing. Relax doesn't mean you're lazy. You're still working hard, but you're trusting God for His timing. I went to Berlin Christian Center. They arranged the tour for me to different churches. Go by train down to Switzerland, to Basel. Big church, traditional church that the charismatic church renting. They rent it because they will keep up the maintenance. They can't pay for it, but they keep up the maintenance so they can use it. But I've never been to Basel, so when I arrived there, 7 o'clock at night, it's cold. At the station, there's nobody there. I don't know where to go. So I think, well, I'm not going to stand here all night. So I walk across the street, this little hotel. I book into the hotel. I get a room. I have a shower. I relax. I thought, oh, well, I won't preach tonight. Relaxed. After a while, they phone me, say, come downstairs. I come downstairs. They speak Switzerdeutsch. That's Swiss German. and come downstairs. He has a gentleman. He says, "Are you Andre Pals?" I say, "Yes, I speak German." He speaks German. He says, "Sorry, I couldn't be there when you arrived, but you're staying with us." And I said, "Oh, I've already booked in." He paid for the night, fetched my things, went with him, and took me to the apartment. And, you know, so he went to the hotel where I was staying. I didn't know, I didn't even have a phone number. I just knew I had to preach there. How God works things out for you. And the big thing about God's timing is that his thoughts are not our thoughts. So his timing is not our timing. We often want God to do something in our timing. And he doesn't. Just to prove to you that he's God. And then he surprises you when he does it in his timing. And then you find out it's far better than it would have been in your timing. Amen? That little girl, she was 8 years old and she prayed next to her bed. "Oh God, make me 20. The Lord answered her prayer in 12 years' time. So, in relating to God, you need patience. That's the first quality of love. In fact, in relating to anyone, you need patience. That you need to wait. The hardest thing for a human being to do is to wait. We hate waiting. They that rush into the Lord's presence shall renew their strength. They shall flutter up like doves, pigeons, making a terrible noise, not getting further than the clouds. And they will be restless and tired for the rest of their lives." I've got another verse. It says, "They that wait upon the Lord for his timing shall renew their strength." While you're waiting, he's renewing your strength so that you can do what you have to do. Amen? If you have to catch a plane, you're in the departure hall, you're all ready to go, announcement comes, plane has been delayed. The whole crowd goes, I say, "Thank the Lord, they're fixing the engine. I'm so happy to wait. Because now I know I'll get there." I had to go to France. And I had to catch the plane in at the airport in Johannesburg. They keep changing the name every few years, but the one there. And before you go, there's so much you have to do because you're going to be away for 2-3 weeks. You have to plan ahead, get everything ready, pay accounts, do this, do that. And I got to the airport, got onto the plane to Johannesburg. And when I got to Johannesburg, my passport was still in my leather satchel in the bottom drawer there in my study. So I phoned Nola. I say, "Nola, my passport is where I normally keep it." "Oh, no." I said, "Oh, yes, it's there." So she phoned Catherine. And she's married to Robert. Catherine grabbed it and drove to the airport. And she got behind a convoy of one of the ministers. She had a free passage to the airport. And when she got there, she went said to a couple that looked okay, "Are you going to Johannesburg on the next flight?" "Yes." Says, "Give this to Andre Pelsa, that's his picture." Gave the passport to them. She phoned me, says, "There's a couple, they're tall and this, and they've got your picture, so But you never look like your passport picture. You know, you always look like a criminal on those black and white things. Because, you know, you're not allowed to smile on a passport or a thing, visa, so it look of you know, net betrap was. And so I'm, you know, marking time there, Johannesburg. Johannesburg Airport, to go from the domestic to the international, is far. So, yeah, the plane lands. Okay, come on. There's a tall couple coming out. I said, ah, must be them. I go to them. I said, I'm Andre Pelzer. They said, oh, are you this guy? I said, yes, that's me. They said, oh, someone gave. I said, I know. Just I ran. Iraq, I ran. But I got through the, you know, the check-in counter, got through customs, ran to the gate, closed. They're busy packing up everything. I said, no. I must be on that plane. Yeah, is there your ticket? They said, it's too late. Can't you read? It's closed. That plane is in the air already. I said, no. I must be on that plane. He says, what? I said, I must be on that plane. He called all the other officials, all the ground staff. Come here. They all stood there. Listen to what this man says. Tell me what you're saying. I said, I must be on that plane that's flying there. They all go, he wants to be on that plane that's flying. It's too late. And they all walked off in different directions. I was so embarrassed. My ore het gehang. And I went to sit down. I thought, man, I did all this trouble, got the passport, and I just sat there. Didn't know. Thought, okay, I can probably buy another ticket, stay the night at a hotel somewhere. But for the moment, I'm just going to sit here. Ek's moeg, ek's nat gesweet. Ek gaan net hier sit. 1 hour later, the ground staff come back to the same gate. Say, hello. They're getting ready for something. I get up. I walk over to them that laughed at me. I said, what's going on? I said, what's going on here? You see, the plane is coming back. I said, excuse me, I want to hear that louder. If we cannot hear you, you must shout a little louder. The plane is coming back. I said, I told you I must be on that plane. Even if God's timing looks wrong, it's still right. The people came back from the buses. They said there was a fault with the engine. They're going to fix it. They give us all in the 5-star hotel for the night, plus a meal, plus breakfast. The man came up to me from the airport ground staff. He says, which church do you go to? I said, I'm a missionary and I have to be on that plane. He says, you're going to fly with the same plane tomorrow morning. I said, isn't that wonderful? hey, God can make a plane turn back just for you because His timing is perfect. And if you go through the history of the Bible characters, I've got a long list here, but we don't have enough time. You're all tired by now. But see the timing of God in their lives. Once you understand that, you start looking for it. And you find it. And you become, you know, we tend to say when God's timing operates, we tend to say things like, what a coincidence. It's not coincidence, it's God's timing. Fancy meeting you here. It's God's timing. I didn't expect to see you here. God's timing. Hey? And so when we begin to trust in God's timing, we relax more in trying to accomplish too much. And trust God that He will help us do what He wants us to do. Sometimes we try to do more than God requires. Sometimes we do less, obviously. But when we understand His timing, we believe it, we confess it, we start living it, it changes your life into an adventure. Because God knows who you are. He knows where you are. He knows how He made you. He knows what He wants from you. He even knows what you want. He says, before you ask, I will answer. He's a good father. Best boss to work for. Best boss to work for. It's the Lord. Amen. Praise God. I want to bless you all and say to you that tonight you're in the right place. At the right time, the right people, this is your time. Everyone say, this is my time. Tell your neighbors, say, this is my time. Amen? It's God's time for your life. Amen? God bless you.
If I can call on my lovely Jasmine and Prophet, Prophet Nola. it'll be me and my lovely Jasmine tonight, having the absolute pleasure of handing out the certificates. And then we'll hand over to Teacher Chantal. Okay, this is your time. Your time to get a certificate, amen? Yeah. Are you ready? Okay, we're going to start with the first year full-time students. What we're going to do is I'm going to read a few names in succession. They'll come up. And then let's give the round of applause at the end of the group, if that's okay with you. Please, if I ask the students here to come up the red carpet and receive your certificate from Jasmine. Okay, first year, full-time, Daniel Lowe, Nonkeba Muchono, Anthony Mufukite, Sivive John Jijaji, Fresher Ndoro, Helen Sauerman, Nicola Basson and Jody Van Bridges. Okay. This is the first time full year students. Let's give them a round of applause. Next is the second year full-time students. And we'll be sad to saying goodbye to some of them. Christopher Collins. Rebecca Scholas. Tabitha Diager. Patience Mashoko. And Amy Corder. Paparazzi. Thank you. And Amy.
Well done, Amy.
Let's give them a round of applause. Second year full-time students. Next, we're going to have learning components also for full-time students. Emma Mulambi. Zimkita Gaba. And Ivan Marshall Mulumba. Those are learning components for full-time students. Next, we have part-time students. Marika Furi. Well, and that's it, part-time students. Marika. And that concludes the full-time students. Congratulations, everybody. Next, we have the Bible cells from the Milnerton area. Sharon Manchest, Jack Bahakwe, Melanie Brooks, Joanna Agnes Kluter, Ivan Kluter, Heather van Niekerk, and Shawnee Brooks. Those are the Milton Bible Cells. Congratulations. Next we have the Durbanville Bible Cell. Johan Malan, Neil Hammond, and Louise Lowe. Durban malaria. Next from Ravensmead, Clive de Kock and Judith de Kock. Lekker in Ravensmeaden. Those are from Ravensmead. Next from Helderberg, Ralton Rogers. Ralton. Give us a red carpet. What don't you just give us a run-up? Yay! Congratulations, Ralton. All the way from Heidelberg. Then Kyalicha. Woo! Kumkani. Kumkani Mududzi Mata. Kailani Mata. Nonklasla Waluwalu. Vuyukazi Waluwalu. Yolanda Matlabane. Unati Damana. Fezeka Nepakade. And Nomvuyiseko Makapela. Let's give them a round of applause from Kyalicha. Next up from Mauriesburg, daar het ons, Danmore, Nyarutsu, and Wainanda Welding, Wainanda Welding. Lekker van Mauriesburg. Then from Paul, Natasha Marwa. Woo! Warren Harris and Melissa Harris. Those are from Paul. Let's give them a round of applause. Just around the corner from there, Mbekweni. Marensha Yuster. Say kom. Sammy Yuster. Zane Kutsia. Elizabeth Kutsia. Louise Joseph. Eleanor Van Roy and Leonie Jacobs. Precious moments. You know, when these moments are captured, you know, they're precious. You're going back to them, you can view them, and you know, brings back good memories, and also you know, you can see where you've come from and how you grow throughout the years. I mean, I remember fondly how I started with MBC and continuing to do so. So we'll just have a few moments of patience with him, as patients are having its perfect work in us. Okay. And Leonie. Well done. That is from Mbekweni. Okay, next is correspondence students. Nadia Tron and Noxie Gaba. Well done, you'll do music piano about this. Okay. Correspondent students. Congratulations. Next, for the youth from the Table View and Helderberg areas, we have Ethan Pelser. Robin Lee Manchest. Michele Paulo Ferreira. Nicolette Kluta. Natasha Lee Kluta. Jade Foster. Talent Muchono. Eli Foster. Taylor Brooks. Chantal Clarkson. Shannon Mentor. Summer Davids. Reeve Worley. No. Summer. There's Summer. Summer. Shannon. This is yours, my dear. This is yours. Let's give them a round of applause from the youth. And then I'm going to call teacher Chantal to hand over certificates for music.
Okay. Didn't know I was doing the reading part, but okay. It's fine. I think, yes.
I will do the reading, and teacher Chantal will do the handing. Piano. This is for music. Learning components in piano. We have Amelie Denton. Amelie, come Amelie. Lamise Bailey.
Well done, Amy.
Noah Orm. Zante Palmer. Now, Zante also gets, besides learning component in piano, also gets first year theory and received a merit for external exam grade 2 UNISA piano and wrote theory grade 2 UNISA. Well done. For which you got 81%. Well done, Amy. Zante? Right, those are piano learning components. Next, vocals learning components to Tabitha Diager. Shawnee Brooks. Shawnee? And Natasha Lee Kluter. That concludes the certificates for tonight. Give yourselves a round of applause.
Good evening, everybody. I'm going to ask one or two students to come up here today, and I'm going to ask them a few questions just so they can share some of the things that they've learned this year at Bible school. And some of them are leaving and some of them are staying to do a second year. So if I could please have Daniel Lowe, class captain for most of 2017, Christopher Collins, Nicola Basson, and there was another student who I asked to join me up here tonight. Who was that? Anthony. Where are you? Please, there. Don't hide. There you go. Yes, we can give them a round of applause. So, Daniel, tell us a little bit about the decision that you made to come to MBC and what that is, how that has impacted your life.
So came to Bible school, just knew I was going to study the Word for this first year. I watched both my sisters go through it, and so I knew sort of what I was getting myself into, but it was still awesome experience being able to just spend time in the Word every single day, and how that affected me throughout the year. It surprised me the more as I went on with it, how the Bible is so much more applicable in every single aspect of every single part of your life, and that really opened it up to me. And it's a light, so it shone on different things, and God dealt with things, and then also gave me hope for the future. Like the Bible says that God gives us plans for us is to give us a future and a hope. And I can say it really did. Spending time in the Word, and I don't know what I'm going to be doing in 20 years, but I know how to hear from God when I'm there, just as I have learned now, and I'm excited for the road ahead of me, and so yeah.
Thank you. Let me just phrase my question properly. So, Christopher, what kind of foundation has MBC laid in your life? And what part will that play in your life going forward, and how it prepared you for what you want to do with your life and the desires that God has placed in you?
I remember coming on the first day of registration in term one in my first year, and the teaching on the day was about how God prepares you for life and things that are on the road. And the metaphor that was used on the day was an aeroplane that's being fueled, and you go through training, you don't go blind into life. That's what MBC basically is. You learn what the controls are, you know how to use them, and the same in the spiritual sense. We learn through MBC, through learning the Word, it lays a foundation in our lives through the Word, which is the root, through the apostles and the prophets that lay down their lives for us so that we can be equipped, and then we can be sent forward and propelled forward, as Actor said for us today, propelled forward to whatever God wants us to do, and our desires then can be fulfilled in Him.
Thank you, Christopher. So those of you who didn't see Anthony on stage on Sunday evening really missed out. We had the second MBC production that I've done with my drama students this year at MBC, and it really was a miracle play that we pulled off in 1 month. And so, Anthony, tell us a little bit about your experience in the drama classes and the things that you've learned from that, and what it meant to you to be a part of the productions that we've put on this year.
Well, first things first, I guess one pointed lesson I learned during the drama classes were, you know, the practical application. You know, during the two classes, you learn a lot, and then you've got your production class immediately after. And, you know, most of the time this year, you know, the theme was dying to yourself. So when you get into that production class, a lot of that has to, you know, you have to apply that, dying to yourself, because not many things you do are comfortable, you know, as a person. You don't want to be in front of people all the time, so you choose to be, you know, drawn back. So when you now have to be on stage and, you know, try to show people the message of that play, it takes a lot from you, you know. So you learn a lot applying where your confidence is, what your intention is in that whole play. Are you trying to put the focus on God or yourself? So it's just basically that. That's one important lesson I learned, that it became easier the more we said, okay, we're doing this for God, not ourselves. So it's that what you learn to practically apply the lessons you learn in your everyday classes. And I absolutely enjoyed every moment of it. It was fun. Okay. Thank you.
So Nicola Vasson, tell us a little bit where you're from. And I want to know the decision that you made to come to MBC when you finished school, and all your friends were talking about going to different universities, and how you went through that and decided to take a year and study God's word, and advice to other people who are finished school and want to and are considering studying God's word.
Hello, everybody. My name is Nicola. I come from Clint William, which is in countryside. making this decision to come to Bible school was not easy for me. I had a lot of opposition again from my friends. They told me I was going to waste my time. But, you know, looking back to this year, I didn't waste my time. God gave me new friends and the right friends that became like family to me. And my foundation and identity in Christ became solid. And I know no one can take that away from me now. And also, Matthew 6, verse 33, that says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of that will be added onto you. And God did reward me because I came into university for next year to study to become a dietitian. And I want to encourage people to come. It's literally the best investment that you can invest in. So, yeah.
So if any of you know of people who are considering studying God's word, or, you know, your kids, or, you know, your friends, come talk to us and ask questions, and we're here, and on the website there's information about MBC, and we'll answer all your questions, and hopefully next year we'll have put out a few little media videos where we can show you what we're doing at MBC in the classes, the spiritual foundation that we're going to plant in your life through God's word. And also how much fun we have in the drama class, and what a wonderful opportunity it is to work together as a team and put on something for God's glory. Amen? All right. God bless you.
Good evening again, everyone.
Oh, thanks. Thank
you. With the theme, the road to discipleship, I looked at the picture, and there's quite a few aspects there on the road of discipleship that we can consider if we think of in terms of fundraising. And you know, that road, it looks like a little road that not much went into it on a farm. It's not pretty, it's not tarred, it's not that smooth, but someone had to clear this road. Someone had to decide, I'm going to go this course. I'm going to go into this direction. And someone had to open it up. And usually on a farm, it means you have to go over it over again, over again, over again until it's clear. So in terms of resources, to open up a road, it takes some effort. And there's resources that goes into it. There's planning that goes into it. You know, on our road of discipleship, in discipling people in the Bible school, there's careful planning that goes into it. There's material that gets worked through every year, carefully. Not because we've gone down this road again, we'll just go through it and see where it takes us. There's planning that goes into it. There's effort from lecturers that goes into it, from students that make sacrifices, like Apostle Aja also mentioned in the beginning. So there's material that goes into just to give you an idea, we print and release a minimum of about 1,000 manuals a year just in Cape Town. That's been printed. So you can work out it's about 50,000 pages that gets released. The Word of God manuals that gets released. That's one aspect to mention. So on our road to discipleship and on our road of discipleship, we being discipled and we disciple others also. So we have an opportunity to help others on this road. We have an opportunity to say, who can we help so that they can be discipled? And there's a scripture in Proverbs 19, verse 17. It says, he who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord. And he, the Lord, will pay back what he has given. Now, when I mention the scripture and you hear the word poor, I'm not looking down on anyone when I say, who can we help? Because if we understand what the word poor means, then it's something else. The poor speaks about there's a need. There's a need. There's many opportunities for students from all over the world to come and study here, and we get many requests and many emails, but they need help to be able to do it. So if we understand the word poor, and if we understand the word pity, it means to bend or to stoop in kindness. So we have an opportunity, like Pastor Actor said, we have an opportunity to switch on those apps, those compassion apps. I'm speaking to your heart, to switch on those compassion apps and say, who can I stoop down to and lend a hand and say, let me help you on this road of discipleship. And we can all do it together. It's a concerted effort. So in the past, over many years, people have contributed and helped and showed kindness and favor to those who want to be discipled through our debit order system with Netcash, where people through that contribute monthly, through making promises saying, I don't necessarily want to do a debit order, but I want to contribute once off or quarterly or in another way. And people would just give a cash donation. We've also had families opening their houses saying, here's a family coming from was it Tanzania? Tanzania, open their house, say, stay here. And Apostle Uwezu went back to Tanzania recently. So in many ways, people have opened their hearts and said, let's help those on this road of discipleship. All of us, everyone that studied and received certificates, we've all received help to be discipled. And we have a exciting and a wonderful opportunity to, like Nicola rightfully said, to invest into someone's life and say, how can we help you to embark on this journey, on this road of discipleship? Amen. So I want to give you an opportunity tonight to make a decision and to contribute and let's help some students. So in the envelopes on your tables, you will find a few things. And I'm just going to guide you through it quickly. You will find a pen, that's very important. You'll find a pen. You will also find, that's a nice noise, that crackling. You will find a promissory note. If you want to make a promise to contribute towards our fund, our MBC fund, you will see on the one side, the left-hand side is for office use, so you can fill in there your details. And the right side with the banking details, you can tear off and you can keep that. You will also find in the envelope a debit order form. If you would like to contribute on a monthly basis, you're welcome to fill in this form. You can do it now. It doesn't take that long. You can fill in the form with your details, your bank details, etc. And you will also find a little slip in there that will give you dates that you can select. Which date, there's about six dates or so that you can select that will suit you best for that debit order to go off. And we use a reputable company named Netcash that we do our debit orders with. So I'm just going to give you a few moments to fill that in, and then I'll ask the ushers to wait on you just to collect those envelopes from you. Amen. If we can have some. I also just want to mention, if you want to give a once-off gift that we can maybe invest and use as an investment to have a sustainable way of helping students, you're welcome to do that, and you can indicate on the promissory note. And also, I want to encourage you. You can also, in your will, you can also create MBC as a beneficiary. We've had people doing that, and that's also something that you can do. And if you need assistance with that, you can also talk to me about it. But it's something that people don't often think of, that you can actually create a beneficiary in your will and testament. Amen. Thank you. 1, 2, 1, 2. Is there anyone that still needs to hand in an envelope or something? Just raise your hands, then I can send an usher to you. Okay. Thank you very much. God bless you for your giving. And like I said, like the scripture says, God will give back to you. Amen. I'm going to hand over to Apostle Aja. Thank you very much.
One, two. Thank you, Pastor Billy. Just want to thank all of you for coming tonight. Thank you to all our speakers, Pastor Andre and everybody who spoke. It was really inspirational. And we hope to continue the work that they began and to follow up with the new roads that the Lord has opened up for us. It's great to hear from the students. It's great to hear the responses from the different areas. And it's also wonderful to see a new generation coming through in the youth that have done some Bible school subjects. Go, guys. It's good to have you here. Amen. Thank you for a wonderful evening. It's really good to have you here. Let's do this again next year and get some of your friends here. We register our next term on the 16th of January at 10 o'clock. And we're busy building our church, so that one will still be in Milnerton. But get someone there. And if people are interested in God and interested in studying the Word, let's tell people about it. Amen. Let's spread the Word. Share this link with a friend. And thank you for tuning in. Thank you for our partners around the world. And thank you for your support tonight. For lending someone a hand on the road of discipleship, I thought Pastor Billy put it very well, didn't he? Amen. Let's just bow our heads and thank the Lord Jesus. Father God, we thank you in the name of Jesus that the word is growing and multiplying. We thank you, Lord, that we are fulfilling your great commission to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. Help us to continue doing this. Let this spread. And thank you for the joy that's here tonight, Lord. Let us enter into the joy of the Lord. Well done, good and faithful servants. Enter into the rest and the joy of the Lord. And we send you into the world to continue the great commission to make disciples and the great command to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. In Jesus' name, everybody say, Jesus!
Jesus!
Amen. God bless you. See you next year. Thanks, Neil.